I feel like the camera is not straight and the lighting today is not good, but if I don't sit down and do this now without overthinking it, it may never happen. It's been quite a blur the past couple of days, and I finally have some time where I feel like I'm both awake and not distracted, and I can do this. So let's do it. This is kind of like my second wrap up for the A to Z readathon. I have 7 books to talk about today, and all of them I did read to count towards the A to Z readathon. So I have been busy, and this may once again be a very long video. So I'm going to jump straight into it. First up is Zeros by Chuck Wendig. Obviously, this is the book I read for the letter Z. I've been wanting to listen to this on audiobook for a while. I'm pretty sure that, like, Denise talked about reading it for the letter Z back in, like, the original A to Z readathon or something, so that's why I went for this one. Unfortunately, I don't think I liked it that much. This is like a cyber espionage hacking techno thriller. It's about a group, kind of a motley assorted group of hackers and internet trolls and cyber criminals who all get caught for their various crimes and are told that if they spend a year working for the government, the US government, in this special program, using their elite hacking skills, they might get reduced sentences. So they don't really have a choice, but they kind of opt in anyway. And they don't really know what they're doing, what the goal of the program is, but eventually, clearly, it has to do with the rise of a nasty artificial intelligence. And they are the only thing standing between the world and this AI that wants to kill everybody, or something suitably dramatic like that. So, 2 things about this. Firstly, I know enough about how cybercrime works and how hacking works and how much time it actually takes to code a special program or tool or whatever to know when parts of this were definitely implausible or inaccurate or just not quite believable. What this read like, especially with the cast of characters, their personalities, the way people talk, the way that it's fast-paced and there's a lot of action and kind of glossing over how things actually happen, it was like reading a Hollywood blockbuster movie script. And I think that if I was watching this as a movie or even as a TV series, I would have enjoyed it a lot more because, to be honest, I have much lower standards when it comes to accuracy and storytelling in American movie making. The other thing is also definitely just my personal taste. This book is very much on the vulgar end of the spectrum. Now, anybody who's read Chuck Wendig's Twitter feed knows how much he likes profanity. There are a lot of bad words in this book, but it's not just that. When I say vulgar, I mean like all the content, all the characters, all of their actions. It ultimately just felt nasty and vulgar in many ways, and I never really was rooting for anybody. I never really liked any of the characters. I never really cared about them. I thought most of them were just kind of bad people, and I never really bought it that they were redeemed or redeemable by the end. And that's what I wanted, actually, from to make this a kind of a more emotionally satisfying story. That's what I wanted to see more, and it didn't quite get there for me. So in the end, I think this just wasn't for me. I think that Wendig's books may just be not my type of thing, especially where profanity is concerned. I just can't take that many F-bombs, so it was all right. I'll probably not run out and read any more of Wendig's books. Next up is The Quarry by Iain Banks, which I read for the letter Q. This was a last-minute replacement for the original book on my TBR, and it was more readable, more my pace than The Queens of Innes Lear, but it is not genre fiction. It's definitely a mainstream novel. And once again, is chock full of characters that I kind of hated and thought they were all awful, nasty people. Just like more so than the characters in Zeros. So this is a story told from the perspective of an 18-year-old boy named Kit. He's definitely on like the autistic spectrum. I would call him autistic. He definitely has difficulty with social cues, interacting with people, having conversations, knowing, you know, just the social niceties, especially when talking to people and stuff. And his father is dying. He has terminal cancer and only has a month or two to live. And so Kit is facing losing his father and then his home in very short order, because the house that they live in is this very old ramshackle estate. It is on the edge of a quarry and it is due to be demolished to make way for the quarry to expand. So basically his father's best friends from university come over for a couple of days, kind of as their last big get together, see their friend before he dies type of thing. And it's a couple of days of really heavy drinking, lots of drugs, and they're trying to find a videotape. They were all like film students in university 20 years before, and they made their own versions of famous films. And this one that they're looking for, the one that is unaccounted for, it's a sex tape. It's porn. They spend a lot of time saying, no, no, it's definitely not a sex tape. No, 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 no. But if anybody saw it, it would ruin our careers. You know right away, it's porn. So they are this sifting through the house and all the stuff stuck in the outhouses and the attics and everything, trying to find this videotape while trying to not tell Kit exactly what they're looking for. And did I mention these people are really unpleasant? They're all adults who act like they never really learned how to grow up. Just ew, you know? They can't be responsible, or they're still partying like they're university students rather than middle-aged people who should know better. And yeah, there's an entire chapter where it's just everybody doing cocaine. And I didn't quite get what the point of it was. I thought at the end that Kit was the only character I really cared for. I was astonished at how well he had turned out when these are the only adults in his life. Like, he actually seemed to have his shiitake together. He seemed to have a plan. He knew himself very well. He knew his limitations, but also like he knew that he could have a life after all this was over with. And I like that. I liked his introspection as well. But I felt like every adult in the story let him down so much in unthinking, uncaring, or just plain vicious ways, especially his father, who was a piece of work. So it was unpleasant to read at times. You know, it's a story about death and dying of cancer and all this other stuff as well. So it was kind of melancholy, but at the end I was more angry about what had happened, you know? So once again, it's a story that's not really my kind of thing, but it was relatively easy to get through. I don't think this is Iain Banks's best work though. For the letters B and D, I read Black Easter and The Day After Judgment by James Blish. These were published separately as kind of novella-length stories, very short novels basically, but they form the first and second halves of a story, and I think that the author kind of intended them to be a single book. You definitely can't just read Black Easter. There's zero conclusion, and you have to read The Day After Judgment to get the second half of the story. I don't know what to call this exactly. I'm gonna say kind of science fantasy. These books are definitely written as science fiction, but the topic is magic. So it's a science fictional take on magic, if magic were real. So it's a world of like the 1960s or 70s where magic is real. It's been practiced by basically Satanists as well as by religious people. You have your white magicians and your black magicians. So the crux of the story is that a very wealthy arms dealer who like has a vested interest in starting the next world war thinks that magic might be real. He tracks down a very well-known black magician pays him money to perform some acts that prove that magic is real, and then this arms dealer says, so hey, if I just like give you all my money, will you let all the demons out of hell that you can for a single night and just let them do whatever they want? And the magician's like, you know, I'm really curious. We should do this as an experiment and see what happens. So they do, and they start Armageddon. And they do not care that the whole world is being nuked back to the Stone Age. They just don't want to die themselves. So, like, I'm laughing about it because it seems faintly ridiculous as I describe it this way, but this story is full of more, like, morally repugnant people. They're supposed to be bad people. There's no way that decent people would have done any of this and messed with the occult or Satanism or demons or anything. But these people want to start wars. They want to go to the extreme evil level, basically. But when they realize that, oh, this might actually be Armageddon, and then Satan shows up and says God is dead, the second half of the story is all this theological question of, is God dead? If he isn't, where is he? How is it that the evil side seems to be winning in Armageddon when we were told that wasn't going to happen? There's one good person in the story, a white magician who was a monk, and he doesn't get to do anything. This is not really a fight between good and evil on the human scale. This one good guy, this monk, is literally just a witness. He is not allowed to do anything. He is explicitly forbidden from interfering with anything that happens. So all he can do is watch, say nothing, and wring his hands. And that was really frustrating. Aside from all of that, it was actually quite an interesting story. I felt like the theological issue at the heart of it confused me somewhat. I didn't quite follow the ending of the story, probably because it is a multi-page archaic poem. And I did not understand half of that, and that's where all the answers are. But I did glean enough to know that the answer at the end was not anything I would have actually predicted. It was quite interesting from the beginning to the end. There were bits of it that were dated. I won't even get into the depiction of women. I will just say they are all sex objects. Even though only one of them is actually human, all the women are literally sex objects. And that was very jarring. In contrast to the other thing I read by Blish this year, I think that Black Easter and Day After Judgment were better. They've just withstood the test of time and aged better. The other thing I read by Blish this year was Cities in Flight, which is like a massive omnibus of four short novels. And those were so old-fashioned, so dated, especially in vocabulary, that I found it difficult to understand what people were saying sometimes, and it was uninteresting because of a lot of that. But Black Easter and the sequel and everything definitely didn't have that problem for me. I would say that its main issues now are going to be some of those cultural, social things like how women are portrayed and things like that. Probably more worth reading than Cities in Flight, in my opinion. After that, I finished Edge of Infinity by Jonathan Strahan. This is one of his Infinity Project anthologies, and I quite enjoyed a bunch of the stories in here, though I was a bit surprised when I looked back to the table of contents that only like three of them really stuck in my mind that much, and I'll just talk about them briefly. I don't feel like I really grasped the theme of this particular anthology very well. Most of the stories are set in like the outer solar system, and I think that's kind of what it is as humanity pushes out from Earth and starts colonizing the moons of like Jupiter and Saturn and stuff. So the notable ones out of here, I would say, are The Girl Thing Who Went Out for Sushi by Pat Cadigan. Pretty sure this is the novelette that won her a Hugo Award. It wasn't one of my favorites, but I like Cadigan's short fiction pretty well, and it was definitely one of the stories that went really out there with human body modification for being in outer space, and that was really interesting. Then there is Drive by James S.A. Quarry. That is one of the Expanse stories. And even though I knew everything that was going to happen in this because it's been adapted into the television series, I still really enjoyed it. It's about Saul Epstein, the creator of the Epstein Drive, which is very important in the spaceships in the Expanse universe, and I really, really like that one. Another one that I really enjoyed was Safety Test by Christine Catherine Rush. I might be one of the few people who really likes this story, I don't know. I liked that it was set in a part of a space station and part of space station life that you don't get to see that often, because it's basically set in a station's DMV, their licensing office, and it is about the guy who gives wannabe pilots their exams. And he has a very bad, no good day. And I really like seeing that side of life, because obviously there have to be agencies and offices who manage this type of thing. You can't just let anybody be a pilot. That's really dangerous. But who's the person who has to winnow out, you know, those people? I think the other one in here that I would mention is Bricks, Sticks, Straw by Gwyneth Jones. This is, I think, the only thing I've read by Gwyneth Jones that I liked. I feel like her style of writing science fiction just hasn't gone very well with me. But this particular story was a very interesting take on, like, not exactly virtual reality, but remote control of observation exploratory vehicles and artificial intelligences in the outer solar system. So you have like people back on Earth and copies of them running in simulations are out there and they get cut off and their simulations are still running and have to survive in kind of like a storm on these moons of Saturn, I think. And just, I thought that was a really cool idea, and the virtual reality parts of like how would these simulations, these artificial intelligences imagine their world, how they would interpret what's happened to them and fight to survive, was just a really cool idea. So yeah, I think this was a pretty strong anthology. There were definitely a couple stories that were not so great for me, but it was a good mix. Some more science fiction. I read this tiny little collection called Saiensu Fikushon 2016. This is a collection of three translated Japanese science fiction stories. They range from like short story length to longer novella length perhaps. And they are Overdrive by To Enjo, which I did not understand. This is about the speed of thought and thought space. And I felt like I was not actually smart enough to understand what it was describing. It was okay. It was a little bit too impenetrable for me, I guess. Then there's Sea Fingers by Toby Hirotaka, which I want to say that of all the books I've read that I can remember right now, the way that this story felt to me, it was kind of like The Emissary by Yoko Tawada, which I didn't really like that book. I didn't like the story, but I liked the way that it was written, the way that the atmosphere in it was created, and I felt like that was kind of similar to Sea Fingers. And the idea in that one is that basically most of the world has melted away into this compressed information ocean thing called the deep, I think. And there are only some pockets around the globe that have survived this, and the people there can kind of like fish things out of the deep with sonics, you know, with sound. And it was really weird, but it felt pretty cool. And then the last story is A Fair War by Tayo Fuji, and it was my favorite story in here. Nobody's surprised about that, probably. It is the longest piece, and it is about basically high-tech warfare and how to level the playing field when you have so much technology it starts to get beyond your ability to deal with in war. Like, how do you counter a lot of the technologies being used and stuff? It's very deadly, and I quite enjoyed it. And the last thing that I finished was How to Be a Tutor by Ruth Goodman. I listened to this on audiobook and I really enjoyed it. I previously read her book How to Be a Victorian, and this one about the Tudor era is the same exact format, just a different era. So I think the subtitle is something like A Dusk to Dawn Guide to Tudor Life, and it covers all of the aspects of life for men and women and for people of very different social statuses and stuff. So it covers farming and agriculture, the kind of food that people ate, when did they eat their meals, their clothing, the types of fabrics they had access to, why was that so expensive, I had no idea. And then some things that I had never heard about or never really thought about, like posture. Posture, just your physical body language, the way that you carried yourself was so important, and I had no idea about this, but you can see that if you see portraits of like really wealthy, powerful people from the era. They have, there's a language to the way that they are posed and the way they're standing and everything, and I never really understood that, and this was one of the coolest parts of this for some reason, just how long it took you to learn how to stand or sit or hold your body in the right way for your social status, why it was so hard to ever pretend to be higher than your social station because you just literally didn't move the right way or you didn't walk the right way. It was so interesting. And the other one was dancing. Basically what I learned from this is that Tudor era youth had like major dance-offs comparable to modern day dance-offs and stuff like that. But most of us never know about that because what we see of dancing from historical periods in movies and TV shows is the really boring stuff. The simpler dances, the simpler dancing styles that actors can learn how to do in a short period of time. But what was actually going on, what people were really into, were incredibly difficult and athletic styles of dancing, like leaping and jumping very high and throwing your partner around and stuff. But yeah, it was a fascinating book. I enjoyed this just as much as How to Be a Victorian. Probably a bit more, actually, because this was an era that I just didn't know that much about. The Victorian era is pretty well represented even in genre fiction, especially like in steampunk, and those things can be pretty well researched even though they're fiction, even though they're alternate history. But there are not as many things set in the Tudor era that I have either watched or read, so yeah, this was a great one. Those are all the things that I finished this past week, and I am now on to my next batch of books for the A to Z Readathon. So I'm about halfway through Four Ways to Forgiveness by Ursula Le Guin. This is a collection of Hainish stories, and it's really good, but it's also a bit difficult to read because it's pretty hard-hitting about slavery and freedom and how that influences sexual dynamics. I have just started reading Gatecrashers by Patrick S. Tomlinson, and I think this is going to be a pretty fun one. It's definitely heavy on the humor and the jokes. I have also started listening to Kraken by China Bieville on audiobook. This is another one that I haven't gotten very far into, so I can't quite say what I think it's about, but it seems to involve giant squid and magic, or inexplicable events in the contemporary world. And the last thing I'm working on is Pavain by Keith Roberts, and this one is really surprising me. I thought it was going to be one thing, and then it turned out to be another. It's still alternate history like I expected, but just very different. And it's more a series of interconnected stories rather than a straight novel or even a fix-up novel, and I'm really liking the whole thing so far. Sometimes there's almost a tedious level of detail, but the stories are very emotionally affecting in a way that I was kind of unprepared for, so that was really good. So those are all the things I'm in the middle of right now. Hopefully I'll be back with another video in a couple of days if my schedule works out. It's been a little bit crazy around here. But once again, thank you guys so much for watching, and I will talk to you again soon. And until then, bye.